Hello, my name is Rishav and I am a graduate student in the Department of Computer Science at the University of Waterloo. Today I'll be presenting our paper Locating Influential Agents in Social Networks with the budget constraint seat selection. Information diffusion can be thought of as the spread of ideas in a social system. As ideas spread in a social system, it becomes important to find influential agents, especially for several applications like viral marketing and stopping the spread of fake news. More formally, we can define the influence maximization problem. We first define the underlying social network as a graph, and the objective is to find a small set of nodes such that when activated, these can spread information maximally throughout this network. These nodes are called influencers. Let's understand budget constraint with an example. Say we have a network of homeless youth and we want to find key influential agents such that we can prevent the spread of HIV in this network. In this case, if the number of influencers is high, there's a high cost of monitoring them. That is why it is often paramount to locate a small set of influencers, and also we may have a limited budget to find them. Thus, these scenarios are called budget constraint scenarios, and this would be the main focus of our paper. Now, we go deeper into the problem of influence maximization. There have been several methods that try to solve the influence maximization problem. The first set of methods we will discuss is the optimization-based methods. These methods use an information diffusion model to optimally select nodes. However, since the influence maximization problem is an NP-hard problem, there only exist approximate algorithms. Again, these methods depend on the diffusion model that is used to find the nodes. The other type of method that we would discuss are the topology-based approaches. In these approaches, users are selected based on topological rules on the underlying graph. For example, centrality-based methods and subgraph decomposition methods. Say you want to find influential nodes and you select the ones which have the highest betweener centrality. These methods are often easy to compute and thus practical. Again, they have a low computation cost associated with them. In this paper, we take a stab at the influence maximization problem with a topology-based approach. Especially, we will look at subgraph decomposition-based methods. Before we go into the details, let us look at the key contributions of this paper. Firstly, we introduce nucleus decomposition. Nucleus decomposition is a subgraph-based decomposition method. We show that nucleus decomposition finds a small number of candidates for influential nodes. Moreover, these nucleus nodes have better per node efficiency than other subgraph-based decomposition methods. We also show that nucleus decomposition has a low compute time compared to other approximate methods while giving similar performances. This allows nucleus decomposition to be used in conjunction with other methods. Finally, we also notice that degree centrality, which is often an ignored metric, also performs really well under some circumstances. So, why are we even looking at dense subgraphs? We know that dense subgraphs exhibit strong connectivity. Thus, we posit that dense subgraphs are likely to contain influential nodes. In fact, there are several papers which have shown that dense subgraph methods like K-Core and K-Trust are good for finding influential nodes. In this paper, we'll talk about three methods, the K-Core, K-Trust, and K-Nucleus. We start with K-Core. K-Core considers connectivity based on node degrees. K-Trust, on the other hand, measures connectivity based on edge participation in triangles. And finally, K-Nucleus looks at connectivity based on cliques participating in other cliques. We will not go into the details of how all of these methods are calculated, but on a high level, we can understand that K-Core looks at degree, K-Trust looks at triangles, and K-Nucleus looks at cliques. So in a way, K-Nucleus is a generalization of K-Core and K-Trust, where if we look at cliques of size 2, they are triangles, and cliques of size 1 are essentially edges. So K nucleus sort of encompasses K tror and K truss. Here we have visualized a toy data set. We can see that if you run the K-core algorithm, it finds a 3-core as the highest core number and looks at the entire graph, whereas we find two different sets of 2 cores and two different sets of nuclei. We can notice that nuclei look at the densest portion of the graph, whereas K-core may find the entire graph. So we can see that as the substructures become denser, the number of nodes found become less, and all of these nodes exhibit high connectivity as promised. So these nodes can thus serve as ideal candidates for inferential nodes. Next, we talk about diffusion models. Diffusion models determine how information is spread in a social network. In this paper, we will look at 3 different diffusion models. The first is the independent cascade. Next, we'll talk about linear threshold. And finally, we will talk about the SIR model. Let us first talk about the independent cascade model. In this model, nodes that are activated can influence their neighbors. Activation proceeds one step at a time. Each directed edge in the underlying graph has a threshold value called propagation probability. We begin with a set of nodes that are initially assumed to be active. The information then flows. At time t, any active node has a chance to activate any inactive child node with a probability, which is equal to the propagation probability. If it succeeds, then the child node becomes active in the next step. If multiple parents are active at the same time, then their activation attempts are arbitrarily sequenced. The process terminates when no more nodes can be activated. Next, we talk about the linear threshold model. In this model, a node is influenced by every incoming node with some weight. Each node has a threshold above which it gets activated. So, at a given time, if the sum of the weights that are incoming to a node become larger than the threshold for that node, the node becomes active. This goes on till no longer activation can occur. We come to the SIR, or susceptible, infected, recovered model. In this model, a node can be in one of 3 states: susceptible, which means not yet affected, infected, and then recovered. A recovery happens after some period of time, and a recovered node is considered to be immune and then cannot spread information any further. To examine the spreading power of a set of nodes, we initially set these nodes as infected, and then we set all the other nodes as susceptible. Then at every time step, each infected node can infect its susceptible neighbors with some probability and then recover with another probability gamma. A node cannot pass directly from the state of infected to recovered in the same time step. The process ends with no more nodes can be affected. We will go over a quick example of the independent cascade model. A node can be in one of these 3 states: inactive node, active node, and newly active node. A successful attempt is shown by a green arrow, and an unsuccessful attempt to activate a child is shown by a red arrow. The probability on the edges show the propagation probability, which allows the node to become active. In the first step, the node seed node tries to activate 2 of its children node. See, only one of this attempts becomes successful, and thus the node W becomes active, while the node Y does not become active. In the next step, W tries to activate its children X and V with some probabilities, and both of these become successful. Thus, X and V both become active. In the next step, X tries to activate U and V tries to activate U. However, both of these attempts fail and U is not activated. Since no more nodes can be activated, the process stops. And we can say that the seed node is able to infect 1, 2, and 3 of these nodes out of the 6 possible nodes. Before moving on to the experiments, let us look at the dataset you will use. We use 4 social network datasets. The first is Wikivote, which is about who voted from whom in an election. The second is Slashdot, which is a social network where people can mark each other as friends or foe. Then in Opinions, we have a Who Trusts Whom network. And finally, in EU Email, we have who sent an email to whom. As we can see, all of these different data sets have different sizes. And we look at various order of magnitudes from 7K to 256K for the number of nodes and 88K to 420K as the number of edges. Next, we run the subgraph decomposition method on all of these data sets. As we can see from the table, Nucleus is able to find the least number of nodes compared to the other methods. Recall that we had seen in the toy example that Nucleus nodes often lie inside the truss and the core. We see here again that Nucleus and truss almost have 100% overlap, whereas Nucleus and core also have 100% overlaps. This shows that Nucleus is able to find even the best connected nodes inside the truss and the core. Since two of our data sets, Opinions and Slashdot, contain ground truth about who trusts whom in the network, this allows us to explore the contextual properties of our subgraphs. We can see that Nucleus nodes in general are more reputable than truss or core nodes. By reputable, we mean that the number of nodes that trust a node V divided by the total in degree of that node. So Nucleus nodes have more incoming edges which also trust these nodes. Finally, we come to the main contribution of the paper. That is, we measure the spreading performance. We define spreading performance as the average number of nodes activated per seed set node, where the seed set node set is the number of nodes found by the maximal truss, core, or nucleus. We also compare two other methods, IIM, which is an approximate algorithm to find influential nodes, and degree centrality. Note that we use directed graphs in our spreading performance analysis. Here we show the results of our simulations. We run the spreading performance analysis for Wikivote, Slashdot, Opinions, and EU Email for the 3 different diffusion models discussed, LT, SIR, and IC, for the 5 methods. As expected, IMM, which is an approximate method, performs the best in general, shown in dark green. This is expected as IMM takes into account the diffusion process and then optimizes accordingly. It is interesting to note that Nucleus, which doesn't have any information about the diffusion process, comes a close second and often beats or is at par with the approximate methods. For example, in EU Email for the IC diffusion method, Nucleus is on par with IMM, and for the linear threshold, it even exceeds IMM. Another interesting point to note here is degree centrality, that is, taking the top n degree centrality nodes, where n is the number of nodes that Nucleus found, we see that this also performs as good as IMM in several cases. Next, we discuss the impact of some of the hyperparameters we had set for our comparisons. We specifically look at the propagation probabilities for the independent cascade model. As expected, as the propagation probability rises, the spreading efficiency increases. This is because with a higher propagation probability, it becomes easier to activate children nodes. At propagation probability of 1, this algorithm would become something like a BFS algorithm. So we can see that the optimal method, which is the IMM, the nucleus and the truss have similar spreading performance as the propagation probability increases for Slashdot, Opinions, and EU Email. This again shows that nucleus is able to perform on par with the optimal method. We clearly see that nucleus performs on par or slightly worse off than the optimal method for three of the four data sets that we have tested. Again, for smaller propagation probabilities, these results are almost similar. Smaller propagation probabilities may represent networks which have low trust and it is difficult for a node to influence other nodes. In such cases, nucleus nodes can perform as good as any optimal or rather suboptimal method like IMM. We finally compare the runtime of the nucleus and IMM methods. Nucleus decomposition in the worst case takes 126 seconds compared to almost 1200 seconds for IMM. Moreover, the memory footprint of IMM is also pretty high. Note that the time for the IMM mentioned here is to find a stable set of nodes. As you know that IMM is an approximate algorithm, it may give different sets of nodes for every iteration run. So, to come to a stable set, we run the algorithm 100 times and take the nodes which come up the maximum number of times in the simulations. Finally, nucleus is a one-time cost, so we only have to run the nucleus algorithm once to find a stable set of nodes. To conclude this talk, we introduced nucleus decomposition for finding influential nodes under budget constraint. We do an extensive experimental comparison of various subgraph methods and also compare nucleus with IMM, which is an approximate method. We show that nucleus is able to perform as well as IMM. We also show that degree centrality, which is an often ignored metric, also performs as good as IMM. Thus, we give some practical suggestions for people who want to find influential nodes in a network. That is, we can use nucleus decomposition to find these nodes, or we can use nucleus decomposition as a starter to reduce the number of seed sets that any approximate algorithm might have to start with. Finally, for future directions, we can look at several things. For example, we can try to combine this nucleus-based method with other content-based metrics to even come up with a better set of influential nodes. We can also try different propagation probabilities and different diffusion models to see whether it generalizes over a wider case or not. Here are some of the papers referenced in the talk. Now we can take up some questions. If you want to find out more about our work, you can reach out to us on these links below.